everyone. Welcome to Modern Application Development Part 2. Okay, now before getting on to a little bit more advanced usages of JavaScript, we want to sort of see how JavaScript can be used for user interaction, right? That is to say, the main purpose over here ultimately is going to be for front-end manipulation, right? So how can we actually use it to manipulate our DOM, right? The API that we are, the APIs that are used in order to manipulate the document that gets displayed to the user, okay? So console.log, in other words, is very limited. It's primarily meant for logging basic errors and can be used for a limited form of debugging, but is generally not useful in production, okay? But the whole idea of JavaScript was that it was designed from the get-go for document manipulation. What does that mean? It means that it can get inputs from the document, right? Mouse clicks, values that are typed into input boxes and so on. And it can also manipulate the DOM. It can actually insert new text. It can modify text that is already present over there and so on, okay? We will be making extensive use of that moving forward. So I'm also just going to demonstrate a little bit of that, just to see how we can, you know, tie some of these concepts together. So for that, what I've done is I've now pretty much commented out everything in the script.js. Let's look at this other file, interact.js, okay? And now I'm going to slowly sort of start looking at manipulating things that are there in our HTML file. So you might have noticed right at the beginning that, you know, line 10 had this div ID equal to D1 and line 12 had another div with ID equal to D2. And in between them, I had this hello world being printed out. Now, when I run all this while I was running things, this hello world was the only thing that got displayed because the other two divs are there in the HTML, but are basically invisible because there's no text in them. Okay. How can I change that? Let's go look at interact.js and say, right, I have this line document.getElementById. So this document is a sort of global variable in JavaScript. You don't have to declare it, it's already there available for you. It's not a keyword, it's actually a global variable, right? And in fact, you can see that, you know, it's declared as var document of type document, capital D document, right? But this is a global variable, you don't get to declare it, you just use it. And this variable, it's an object that has several different methods, one of which is getElementById. So I can basically getElementById D1, and that is going to pick up my first div. And what I'm going to do with that is to say d1.innerHTML equals welcome to D1. Okay. So what do I expect is going to happen? This HTML that I have out here, when I run this new script, right, the page will load, it will then run the JavaScript, and the JavaScript should cause some new text to get inserted into D1, which means it should come above the hello world. Let's try that. And sure enough, we see that if you notice carefully, there was a small break, right? It basically showed hello world and then welcome to D1. That gap is because the hello world was there in the HTML that got displayed first. Then the JavaScript ran and resulted in welcome to D1 being inserted on top. Okay. What happens if I also put something into D2? Once again, all going too fast, but you can see that, you know, hello world came first, then welcome to D1 and goodbye from D2, more or less, you know, in quick succession, because the JavaScript, once it starts running, is very fast. Now, this, what I'm going to show now, this function out here, is definitely something that is a bit advanced and will require a bit more explanation, which we will have to get to after we have talked about asynchronous functions, okay? For the time being, what you can assume is that, you know, I'm going to do a few things. I'm going to just print out something to the console. And this await new promise is essentially going to wait for 2 seconds, okay? After waiting for 2 seconds, it's going to do something, which is modifying the d1.innerHTML and also logging something to the console. After that, it'll wait for another 2 seconds and modify d2.innerHTML and log something to the console. Okay. Now, you will notice that I can't just have those lines over there directly. It won't run, in fact. I need to wrap it around this async function. I need to create a new function called demo and then call that function. That's the only way of running it. Okay. Now, why is all that? We will get to that later. But for the time being, let's see what happens as a result, right? When I run this, I see hello world up there. After 2 seconds, welcome to D1 pops up. And after another 2 seconds, goodbye from D2 pops up, okay? So I can bring in this notion of sort of timeouts and, you know, interactivity just based on time even into the picture by doing this. And of course, the next most interesting thing that we could probably do over here is to say, okay, you know, all very well to say that we have timeouts and, you know, changing text. Can I get input from the user? Okay. And this is an example of that. I declare a variable x. And once again, you know, get d1 as get element by id of d1. And I say d1.innerHTML is going to take this value, click count $x. Notice the template with the back ticks over here, right? But now I'm going to add something else. I'm going to basically put in this thing which does an event listener. Okay, this is a new, another method which is bound to this d1, right? So whatever came out of this document.getElementById, right? It's some kind of an object. And that object has a method called addEventListener, which takes in two things. One is click, and the second is a function. I don't want to declare a function first and then use it. I just directly use arrow notation. Okay, so this E, right arrow, and open parenthesis and open brackets, close brackets, right, is effectively a small anonymous function that I've created over here just for directly using within the addEventListener. This is an example of where the arrow notation or the anonymous functions make sense. I don't have to declare this function ahead of time because this is the only place I'm going to use it. Okay. Having said that, there's nothing wrong with declaring it and then, you know, putting that name in there. And in some cases, it might actually make it more readable. In this case, arguably, you know, it's like easy enough to understand because this is like a sort of standard, what's called an idiom of the code, right? A standard way of expressing certain things. Now let's think about what this is going to do. It's going to increment x each time I click on it, hopefully. Set the value to be the count. And I'm doing something interesting, which is that I'm going to set the font size, okay, which is actually one of the style parameters corresponding to this div, to something like x plus 10. Why am I doing x plus 10? Because if I give it 0, then it will probably be too small. Okay. Now this looks interesting. Let's see what happens when we run it, right? I got the hello world, and then, you know, after a brief pause, I got click count 0. Okay, interesting. Let me go, if I go click somewhere randomly out here, nothing happens. But if I click on D1, right, I see that I see click count 1. It actually became a bit smaller because now it's using 11 pixel font size, whereas previously it was using something bigger. What happens when I keep clicking? You can see that it starts getting bigger, right? Because with each click, the font size is correspondingly going at this point is like 22 point, 25 point font, 20 point, 30 points, right? I can keep going, right? This, unless at some point, you know, the font size becomes too big and the system crashes, right? So what's the, you know, idea behind this? We have interactivity. We had some way by which we could sort of get things to the point where, you know, I could take input from the user by means of mouse clicks, associated with a function that gets called, and manipulate something on the DOM that then gets displayed to the user. Okay. Moving forward, we'll be making extensive use of all of these things to see how we can, you know, put all of this together in order to build up more interactive and a better interactive applications and a better user experience.